All right, guys, so I'm going to go through the problem that we went through in class. I'm going to do it the way that we did it in class, just so that you have access to that. There's another video on the website which will go through exactly the same question, except it goes through it in another way. So make sure you at least see the other way. You can watch this way again if you want, just so that you have an idea of how it works. Okay? Now, the problem here is that 2x plus 3 and x minus 1 are factors of 2x to the 4th plus ax. Cube minus 3x squared plus bx plus 3, and we're supposed to be finding a and b. Now, the original question, as you'll notice on the website, said that we should also be finding the zeros or the roots. I'm not going to worry about that here because I'm just finding a and b. Once you get there, then the process is the same as in the other video, which is on the website. So we're just going to start with this and we'll go from there. Okay? So, one way to do this is by using substitution, right? It was mentioned in class that we know that if 2x plus 3 is a factor, then that means that negative 3 halves, if x equals negative 3 halves, that should make the function equal to 0. All right? It was also stated that because x minus 1 equals 0, then that means that 1 is another one of those zeros or factors. Now, using synthetic substitution or regular substitution, we can then get a couple of equations that help us out. Okay? Now, in class, it was mentioned that I could just take the 1 and put it in for x and set it equal to 0, and then I'd have an equation. And that's correct. The other thing you can do is just straight up use the synthetic substitution, which is exactly the same thing. So I'm going to take this 2x to the 4th, and I'm going to take the coefficient of the x to the 4th, the coefficient of the x cubed, the coefficient of the x squared, the coefficient of the x, which is b, and then the constant here at the end, and by using substitution or synthetic substitution, I'm going to put this 1 in. So I'm going to put the 1 in. So the way that we do this is we bring down the 2. 1 times 2 is 2. So a plus 2 would simply be a plus 2. 1 times a plus 2 would again be a plus 2. Negative 3 plus a plus 2 would be a minus 1. Negative 3 plus 2 is negative 1. A minus 1 times 1 would be a minus 1, b plus a minus 1, so I would have b plus a minus 1, and then 1 times that again will give me b plus a minus 1, add those together, and I would get my final result of b plus a plus 2, 3 plus 1 is 2. Now, if you were to just put the 1 straight in here, you should get essentially the same thing, okay? Except you'll end up getting some of the coefficients, right? You'll end up getting 2 plus a minus 3 plus b plus 3. And if you put all that together, you're going to get exactly the same thing as we got here. Here, we're just doing it synthetically. We're recognizing that this needs to be 0, right? Number 1. This is one of the roots, one of the zeros, which means if I put that into the function, it should give me 0. Secondly, some of you are recognizing this as being synthetic division, and that's true. When I divide, I should get a remainder of 0. All right, so we've got one formula right there, which would be b plus a plus 2 equals 0. But, of course, because there's two variables, I need two functions, and so therefore I need another one. You can either put the negative 3 halves into the original function right here, which is what you'd be doing if you were to just take the negative 3 halves and put it in for each of those x's, or you can put it into the one that we've already got. Now I'm going to put it into the one that we've already got because I know that eventually I'm going to want that function anyway, right? So I'm going to go ahead and right here, I'm going to do synthetic substitution again. I'm not going to need to worry about this last piece because the last piece I've already worried about, that's equal to 0. The remainder was 0, so that really is going to go away. So again, I'm going to put in the negative 3 halves this time, bring down the 2. Negative 3 halves times 2 is negative 3. And a plus 2 minus 3 would give me a minus 1. Negative 3 halves times that. Now we're going to get a little bit more nasty, but you know what, we can deal with it anyway. Negative 3 halves a plus 3 halves, because negative times negative would give me a positive. When I put those together, I'm going to get a negative 1 half a, and then a plus 1 half, and then I multiply that by negative 3 halves, and negative 3 halves times negative 1 half is going to give me L alone. I'm going to have the plus A and the 3 fourths A, which is going to give me plus 7 over 4 A. And then the negative 1 and the negative 3 fourths, which is going to give me a negative 7 over 4 A. Just negative 7 over 4. And so again, I have this result, which needs to be the 0. All right? So I now have that B plus 7 over 4 A minus 7 over 4 equals 0. And so now I've got two functions up here. I've got two functions, two variables. I should be able to solve those. And I can do that through substitution, elimination, whatever else you want. And so I'm just going to rewrite it as A plus B equals, move the 2 over, equals negative 2. And then I'm going to do the same thing here. First, I'm going to multiply this by 7. By 4, because I find denominators annoying, like most of you do. And so I'll have 4b plus 7a minus 7 equals 0. So I've got 7a plus 4b equals 7. And then I just need to eliminate one of the variables or subtract and do substitution. Whatever way you want is fine. I'm going to go ahead and multiply everything by negative 4. So I'll have a negative 4a minus 4b equals 8. Put all that together, the 4b's eliminate. 3a equals 15, a equals 5. Now if a equals 5, because 5 plus b must be negative 2, that means that b must be negative 7. So I've solved for a and b using synthetic substitution, using the idea that if this is a factor, the remainder should be 0. And once I've done that, then I should be able to find the other zeros if necessary. I can use this right here. If I put a in, then I now have a quadratic, which is the result of dividing by the two factors I already had. That's why I did it this way, just because if I wanted to take it further, I could then take this quadratic now that I have a value for A, and I should be able to solve then for the other two roots. All right, the answers you'll see on the slides that are